welcome to episode one, Hard Cuts. Hard cuts are the basic editing technique. They're technically a type of transition, but I think it's way easier to look at them as a lack of transition. So you're literally cutting immediately from one clip to another with no kind of dissolve or effect in between the two. This is what gives it a hard edge and a hard name. If you look at this on your timeline, the image on the left-hand side of the screen is literally being replaced by the image on the right-hand side. The image on the right-hand side is called the incoming clip. As your timeline scroll bar, or your time indicator moves along your timeline telling you where you are, there'll be two video files, one on the left, one on the right, and one clip is about to be reached and the other one is about to finish. That's why you've got the outgoing and the incoming. And if there's no transition between them, it's gonna just hard cut. You're literally gonna have one image, bam, changes to another one. One of the best analogies I think you can look at it when you're looking at film is building a house. So if you imagine a house made of bricks and each brick is a shot in the film, you're basically reading this house from left to right, and the hard cut is the centimeter or two of cement in between all the bricks. Now, as a viewer, as someone casually strolling past a house, they're like, oh, that's a house made of bricks. But we, the editors, we see the cement, we see the little bit of information that's just saying it's going from one brick to another. However, as we get further into the series, we're going to look at all the different other ways that the bricks can be broken up and dispersed. So that's with windows and doors and all kinds of fanciful things that are going to have different effects and impacts on the audience. The reason this image works so well is because if you think about how most bricks are all the same length, which means there's a sense of continuity and flow to the bricks and inevitably in this metaphor to the film. Most shots are actually a very similar length in each sequence. This gives a certain scene a rhythm and a flow, which makes it unjarring. It allows you to smoothly read the film as an audience viewer. You can see here in this timeline that this finished edit of the film, actually most of the shots are very similar in length. And that's not just on purpose, but it's the natural flow of the film. As you play each clip, try pressing the pause button, the space key, at what you think is the point the shot should cut to a different shot. Then don't do anything, rewind it back and do it again. And once you start to hit the space bar on the same moment several times, you're gonna start to realize that that's the point that instinctively and naturally is the edit point, at least as far as you're concerned. You've got to start trusting your instincts and you've got to start feeling the flow of the scene. So when you have a longer brick, you're essentially having a longer take. Now, the reason it's called a long take rather than a long shot is because long shot is a descriptive term used to describe a wide angle shot, whereas a long take is descriptive and specifically about the length of the shot. If you have a series of long takes and then they're interrupted by a sudden short take, then it's obviously going to be very disrupting for the audience. Take a look at this sequence from my film Glove Compartment. You can see how these really short takes essentially show that they aren't part of the natural flow of the film. Obviously this works in conjunction with the actual images, which differ drastically in terms of content to the main flow of the scene. The shots are differentiated from the main action and allows the audience to separate out this information as something which doesn't belong. Similarly, another aspect which will make a scene jarring for your audience is just simply cutting to whoever's talking. It's not a natural mode of editing. What you want to do is cut your scene around the protagonist of the scene. So if you have a dialogue between a protagonist and another character, whoever's talking isn't necessarily the most interesting thing going on in that scene. For instance, if you think about a protagonist who's being given lots of information that are going to help them on their journey, for instance, maybe Frodo finding out Mordor was that way, then his reaction and his response to that, especially because this is the character we're supposed to be investing in as an audience member, is going to be way more interesting. We don't want to just be looking at who's talking, we want to be looking at how the main character is responding. So, cut to whoever's talking to identify they're talking, but then think about what is the flow? Who do I want to see? Am I just being cut to the person talking because that's easy, that's the easy way to edit the scene. It doesn't take any creative thought. What you want to do is start thinking about what is interesting, what is captivating. is a ring, is like a ring of a glass going on in somewhere else in the room, is that more interesting to us than the person talking? Is that what the attention of the protagonist is on? There's so many different things that you can show the audience that are going to be more interesting than the person talking. However, let's say you have like an argument scene, then it's going to be useful to cut to exactly who's talking as they start talking, because it's not a natural mode of editing, and it's going to be really horrible, and it's going to be really jarring, and that is the intended effect of an argument. If you want an argument to seem overwhelming, if you cut really quickly and really aggressively and straight to whoever's talking, it's going to be really hard to follow the scene, and that's why it's often used in argument scenes rather than a normal or easygoing conversation. As with everything, however, I'm discussing in this series, all these rules are made to be broken. The most important thing you can ever take away from this series is just to cognitively think about what it is I am saying, what it is the effect might be, just to start opening up your minds to all those ways that things can be seen is the most important thing. So that means that whilst I've given you some rules of thumb on how hard cuts can work and how we can use them to cut to specific things, that doesn't necessarily mean I'm always right. There are going to be so many other examples which break from these rules, but this is a pretty simple way to get you up to speed and to get you going.
Whilst we're going to cover scene coverage in a later episode, it's also important for you to try and understand how the scene's going to unfold before you start cutting it. If you jump in and you start just going crazy with your shots and you try to overshow things, it's not going to work. So what you need to do is just sit back, maybe even close your eyes, and just try to imagine the final edit in your head. How is the scene being told? Imagine what Tarantino would do. Imagine what different filmmakers would do. How would they tell the scene? And the bottom line is, you may feel like you're trying to copy them, but ultimately, the way the scene is unfolding is coming from you. It's coming from how you understand cinema based on what your experience of it is from other filmmakers.
So what I've given you this time is I've given you some dialogue footage, because I think that's a really good way for you to practice editing a scene. Try focusing on who's responding and how they're responding, who your protagonist of the scene is. It might be different to mine, and then you can think about how you want the scene to flow as well. So think about length of cuts. If you throw in some, obviously some jarring shots, what is the function of that? What are they doing other than the fact that it looks cool? Because communication to the audience and to the other crew members is one of the most important things when it comes to filmmaking. So thank you very much for watching, and hopefully this was useful. Next time we're going to be taking a look at crossfades and dissolves and some of the really cool ways they can be used to tell the audience certain bits of information, and also the way they can be used to creatively disrupt the narrative and change it or bend it, which is going to be really cool.
Feel free to edit them, play around with them, have a go at practicing what I am telling you about in this episode, and then next week there'll be some more footage in the description below as well for you to download and practice creating scenes that will be employing the techniques that I'll be discussing in each episode.